To achieve liberation. Like Angela Davis said, it's built into the system.
Nowadays I can't believe what's going on in front of me. I don't want to watch TV and find another casualty. I don't want to read the news. My heart's already black and blue. I'm putting on my combat boots, 'cause I got an attitude. Like soldiers forced to fight a war. What the hell? I can't take it anymore. 'Cause for so long we've been patient, now we're done. And don't you even ask me, when did I become such an angry black woman?
We can't successfully put an end to racial discrimination until we change the entire system.
We've been trying to keep the peace 50 years since Martin King. Some don't like me for who I am, but I love my melanin. Another future college grad sleeping in a body bag. Mother screaming out her lungs, she never gonna see her son. We're like soldiers forced to fight a war. What the hell? I can't take it anymore. 'Cause for so long we've been patient, now we're done.
It's not right. Just keep it going.
They see something that I don't see. What can you learn from a bum, Omar? Shamsuddin? What I learned from a bum, maybe it's what not to do.
Snuffing up 7 easy. There's a reason why, after 100 channels destroyed, Angel Snuffing Up 7 is still here. There's a reason why nobody wanna get in a beat with change it, Snuff Nuff 7. But you don't take me seriously.
This is a story about control. My control. Control of what I say and control of what I do. And this time I'm gonna do it my way. I hope you enjoy this as much as I do. Are we ready? I am. 'Cause it's all about control. And I've got lots of it.
Feel it up, feel it up.
Don't get touched, feel it up.
And now, the breakdown.
Ready to live?
Yes, sir.
All right, sure.
Okay, well, welcome back to Reality Temple Ministries on Internet Ministries on Earth. And I'm your topic that and it's called actually Are Soul People Awaiting Extermination? Now, I just want to touch up on some things dealing with this topic, because as I look around, you know, and see the world as it's evolving every day, well, it's things that are evolving in society is concerned. I also see our people further regressing back. You know, I want to say this to soul people. And as you already know, those of you who watch this platform know what people I'm talking about. I'm not just talking about any other people. I'm talking about those that are referred to as Black or African American or Balaoyan or the tribe of Shabazz or Moors or, you know, these other names that's given to us by the races and those who copy behind the races. And, you know, we're called, of course, the nigger word, you know, and the coon word, you know, and the Uncle Tom word, and the list goes. Okay, once again, this is your soul brother Talia. And what I was before, I was technically interrupted, and hopefully I won't have to go through this where we just have to do this from phone audio. But I just want to say that right now where soul people in this country stand in 2023 going into 2024, I must say that, you know, we've gotten to the point, and it's not just because of the COVID pandemic.
Yeah, brother, you don't have to do this over the phone, man. I apologize.
That's all right. Go ahead.
Well, okay, back to you, family. Once again, I'm your number two soul brother, Talib, speaking live from the platform of Realities Internet Ministry, Temple Ministries on Earth. And I was going in on the topic about our soul people. Of course, speaking of us, those of us who are descendants of slaves, dark-skinned slaves who were born here in America. And the topic I was talking about was our soul people awaiting extermination. And no further more interruptions, fortunately. But I would like to say that, you know, I really can see that we are waiting for extermination simply right now, because we are doing nothing at this point in 2023 going into 2024 to change our condition. And, you know, I saw Soul Brother Talib's video earlier that he had just got done doing. And I'm going to just piggyback even a little bit off of basically what was said in that live. And, you know, going to the Quran, first of all, and to those of you who know I don't subscribe to religion or spirituality, but as one would say, you can learn from anything when it comes to the truth. Mm-hmm. and equating it with reality, point blank. You can even get the truth from the so-called devil. How about that, you know? But anyway, I just wanted to just say that the Quran speaks about Allah not helping those or helping the people unless they want to help themselves to change what's in their hearts. Okay. So the Quran says that Allah would not change a people's condition until they change what's in their hearts. And for those of you Muslims, regardless of whatever sect in Islam you belong to, that know the Quran or quote the Quran verbatim, like you always talk about you do, you should know that. And apparently, we have not changed our condition even since during the time of the Civil Rights Movement over 50 years ago. We have not further advanced ourselves even from that point, nor carried out the work of those who set that movement in motion to better our circumstances here in America as a group. And once again, like I said, we haven't even further advanced from that point. So we're still stuck back into the Civil Rights Movement of the 1950s and 60s. We're still stuck back into the old teachings of Noble Drew Ali, Marcus Garvey, and Elijah Muhammad, and these other different teachings that foreigners brought to us in America that are outdated, okay? And we have not advanced from none of that, period. Mm-hmm. So we still stuck in the past altogether. And as a result, we as a group are regressing. Let's look at our younger generation. Go look at the entertainment, sports world scene. You can see definitely clear evidence of that, how savagely we are regressing as a group in this country. You know, anytime, like I heard a relative of mine say, but I haven't seen it, but I wouldn't doubt that it's going on in the so-called world of hip hop. But they say now some young female out there, I assume a soul sister, that's singing a rap song that's going viral throughout social media and other, cinema or radio outlets around the country and the world talking about she has a pink putty tan and a brown asshole, as to that effect, talking about in between her booty. See what I'm saying? So, and like a relative told me, he has kids, and that's very disgusting to him that even people like his kids got to listen to that type of stuff. You see what I'm saying? So when you have this savage regressing going on in this country with us as a group that's still barely over 100 some years out of slavery, which we ain't even made it to 200 years yet out of slavery. You know, that says a whole lot, you know, as to our digressing point blank period as a group, because we have failed beyond from beyond being what those of you would call the people. We don't even qualify even to be recognized by that title, unfortunately, any longer. We may have had a chance during the civil rights movement to be able to even call ourselves that. But we digressed even backwards from that point. I mean, you could see it on all levels of disrespect, uncivility, when it comes to how we deal with each other, how we talk to each other, and even how we deal with other people, well as in some cases like we deal with ourselves, you know, because even the rest of the human population amongst us don't respect us and really don't have nothing to do with us unless they're using us, especially when using us against each other, you know. So, you know, we have this situation going on, you know, where it's at the point now, you know, like I was even talking to a young brother locally here who's a college student in my area. And I was just having a little few minutes of chat with him, you know. And, you know, I mentioned that me being in my 50s, that I didn't see back in the 70s and 80s where they were killing younger black children and men and women like they are now in his generation. And that's a sign of us regressing as a group, you know. And see, the thing is that now we are coming to the point where we cannot even embrace each other unless it's about, do you got some money? Do you got enough money to get up on some dope? You know, or let's go, or do you got some money to get up on a 40 ounce? You know what I'm saying? Or a half a pint of liquor, you know? Them are becoming more, that conversation amongst us is becoming more bigger and bigger. Then, at least not mentioning the big divorce rate between soul men and soul women in this country, which I was told by someone recently that's at the highest of 78%. You know, when we were once, even coming out of slavery, known to have long-lasting marriages as a group, which helped keep the so-called black family together, you know. But now, the divorce rate between us is 78% from what I was told. But that's still, however high it is, that's still in the range of a high number. And I mean, you know, it don't necessarily these days, because of the mass social media era and the internet and all that kind of stuff, you could just easily find out things without going through researching certain traditional books and stuff like we used to have too. Or even like someone in once in a conscious community would say, it's going to come a time where truth is going to be passed around by way of mouth and ear, you know? And apparently, because of what's happening, now people are starting to even see that, you know? So, I mean, it's like, you know, we are coming to a point where we have no you know, we're not even seen as a threat in this country, like we to a certain point was, especially when the government during the time of the civil rights era and the so-called pro-black power movement of the 60s and 70s was watching us like hound dogs, you know, because we were considered as a threat to that, to this nation's national security. Okay, now, back forward to what I'm saying is that, you know, we don't even pose that type of threat no more, especially because of our dyslexic so-called black leadership in this country. And we have no type of integrity when it comes to our own worth as a group, when it comes to protecting our women and children or each other, period. We don't even have that, because like the late Malcolm X would once say, it was a time when if a black man seen another black man getting attacked by a racist, they would run over and help that brother. Nowadays, it's different. And that's even more true now in 2023, you know? And it's got so bad in this country, even here in my area, where, you know, I can see where you have a bunch of soul brothers posted on the sidewalk, hanging out in front of a bodega or a supermarket or something like that, in what they call a hood, you know. And you'll see them staring at somebody straight like me, that's just trying to get by about my business. But they'll see a bunch of white people and won't even look at them or get them that crazy stare look or nothing, like they would somebody like me. Like they on some type of attack mode thing. You see what I'm saying? So this is how far our people have regressed. And we've even regressed to the point where we just all out right call each other the nigger word in front of even the racists and don't care. It was a time I remember in my younger life that if a black person was heard calling another dark-skinned person the nigger word or going off acting ignorant in that capacity, a brother or sister would try to pull him to the side and be like, hey, hold up. You see all these white folks around here? What did you do? What are you doing? You see what I'm saying? What are you doing? You see all these white folks here and you calling so-and-so the nigger word and da-da-da and all that? Now, we don't even have that type of integrity about ourselves as a group. So what we'll do is we'll talk about each other in that manner and in all other kind of ill manners right in front of the racists. Then you get quick and ready to want to scream on the racists when they call us the same thing. And even these other groups of people in the country. Well, when you let them watch you do it, you see what I'm saying? That's the type of disrespect that you indirectly or directly are inviting towards your own selves. Or our people are inviting toward ourselves. You see? So it's like don't care anymore. It's been gotten to that point. It's like in these rap songs, and just like even out in the public, we'll call our own, not only our own mothers the B word, but our grandmothers, our great grandmothers, the B words. You know, and I hate to even mention something about those that I am actually related to by blood, but I have to even tell the truth sometimes in that case. Because I have a young relative that's close to turning 18 and still is barely a teenager, okay? And she's already physically had fights with her own father, her own, and also had a fight with her sibling's grandmother, because they don't have the same grandmother. But she actually had a fight with her own two sibling, younger siblings' grandmother, who's in her 70s somewhere. You see what I'm saying? So, I mean, we've lost respect to the point for our elders. You know what I'm saying? Where we don't have no grip or control on how we deal with each other. We don't have no type of checks and balances. You see what I'm saying? But then you get these wacky conscious, so-called pro-black conscious groups, like the Nation of Islam or the Pan-Africans or the Moors or the Nuwabians, or whatever they want to call themselves, you see what I'm saying? And they justify this type of behavior by saying, well, you know, our brothers and sisters just coming up out of that ignorance, you know, so you got to give them time to grow. No. It's still brothers and sisters today that have been in them teachings, even to the point before me and Talib probably was born. That's still in that state of ignorance. You see what I'm saying? So, I mean, as far as that go, apparently, one can miss me with that. And I mean, you know, it's like, you know what I'm saying? That's not justifiable. There's no way in justifying that. You're supposed to be teaching us how to be civilized, but yet you give out these weak suggestions. I mean, hell, this is the reason why I respect the so-called black Christian more than I do the black pro-blackity so-called conscious ones, because at least they acting out the true character of what they are because of what they've been indoctrinated with. So they don't shed no excuse on that like those in the so-called pro-black conscious community do. You see what I'm saying? So here's the thing. You know, we're just that ignorant right now. Even to the point that if you even try to address us, let alone those in the streets, that is just so far gone that you'll be taking a chance on losing your life trying to, you know, help stir into the right direction of having some type of kind of civility about self. You see what I'm saying? And this is why, piggybacking off of what the brother said earlier in his own live, solo live, you know, was that we're not here to save people. We're only here to give advice. And that's just that simple, you know, because most of us are grown folks. and we should have some common sense to know better. You see what I'm saying? As to what's going on. But apparently we don't. So, you know, when we get ourselves caught up out here, whether it be with the law or whether it just be with other people in the streets and put ourselves in crazy, deadly situations, then you want to have somebody like Reverend L. Sharpton or Benjamin Crump get on there on the front TV tube talking about, oh, these people shouldn't, it shouldn't have happened to them. Yeah, it shouldn't have happened to them. But you got to forget. You forget they opened up them doors for that tragedy to happen to them. You get these parents out here. You know what I'm saying? Like I heard a brother tell me, he was watching some video on YouTube, and he said that it was a brother standing on a corner in a Seoul neighborhood, you know, actually holding up a sign telling people not to pay for these funerals or these Seoul people that be getting shot at the hands of the police. And I had to concur with what he was saying in regards to that. Because a lot of times we do stupid stuff to ourselves and each other to where we end up getting killed or getting killed, of course, by law enforcement in this country. And then want people to donate to our Cash App. You see what I'm saying? Or to our, what's that other one they use, brother? That other one, like Umar Johnson had them sending money to?
GoFundMe.
Yeah, the GoFundMe thing, yeah. Yeah, you know, you have people wasting their hard-earned money to go fund you. For something that your stupid ass child then did to get themselves caught up in a situation that they got caught up in. You see what I'm saying? Because as we know, and like I said earlier, the truth is the truth, no matter how it's being presented, especially in this pure form, you know. The unadulterated truth is that a lot of these people did this to themselves, which we shouldn't have to bear the responsibility for by helping to donate to their family's funeral expenses to help bury them and all that kind of stuff. Hell, I know people every day in this world die. And got bodies sitting up in the morgue with toe tags on them. Rotten. Because nobody ain't trying to claim them bodies. You see what I'm saying? It happens all the time, every day. See? But yet somebody knowingly, who may have been known as a criminal among us, or a gang member of some among us, a drug dealer or whatever, and do crazy stuff and get themselves put in a situation, now everybody else got the better brunt of it. No, I can't agree with that. And it's wrong, and it's unfair to those who have the better responsibility brunt of helping some family bury their own relative when they should come up with their own money and do it if that's the way they want to do it. You see what I'm saying? So, I mean, it's like, you know, at the end of the day, in that same family, they probably don't even like a lot of them people, knowingly or unknowingly, that's donating to their GoFundMe. You see what I'm saying? Next time you see them around, one of them might ask you, what you looking at, nigga?
Huh.
or even be ready to pull a pistol out for you just because they felt you glanced at them. You see what I'm saying? This is how retarded the so-called black community in America has become. This is actually, and you know, I can't stop no more than what I've been saying regarding so-called black families. Listen, like I always tell people, whether they accept it for the truth that it is or not, like I always tell people, look, your family is those that's with you in heart. And ain't necessarily got to be blood relatives. That's something that mankind came up with as a tradition when it came to, you know, you birthing kids in the world, and now you got to help pay or work toward taking care of them. That's where the meaning of so-called family came from. Okay. And it wasn't no invention by an unquote spiritual divine God that term came from either. Okay. That all started, you know, with an ideal made up by man. Mm-hmm. You see what I'm saying? So, therefore, that separates that point from the biological aspect of being related to someone by blood. You can't help that. But one thing you could know is that being related by somebody by blood, whether it was through default or however the case was, that don't mean that person is family to you. So in other words, that could be any other joker from the streets that happened to be your biological cousin, father, mother, aunt, uncle, grandmother, great-granduncle, or great-grandauntie. You know, so that ideal people get about family is none void. I've known relatives that have actually had people killed that wasn't by others, that wasn't kin to them.
My black people, it's all about the
unity.
They can do it,
that's
so ain't nobody
moving. To them or their relative, and had that relative killed by them. You see what I'm saying?
Stand by for countdown. Prepare audience for maximum impact.
Full immersion in the
universe.
You see what I'm saying?
It's not going. Hey. Just keep it going.
Kill each other. One of their relatives died and leave a nice chunk of money behind to be ready to kill each other over it. You see what I'm saying? Over life insurance policies and all that kind of stuff. That actually destroys what is ever left of what is called a family. You see what I'm saying? So that family thing and relative by blood. It can't be denied. Not from the time when the man first stepped foot on to now. And even till maybe the whole human population is wiped off this earth. But that meaning relative to family has a different contrast in context to it when it comes to the two words being contrasting and meaning toward each other. So it is Again, it is a difference between
throughout the history of the United States, the construct of racism was created specifically to oppress black people, to try to suppress our determination to achieve liberation. Like Angela Davis said, it's built into the system.
Nowadays I can't believe what's going on in front of me. I don't want to watch TV. It's find another casualty. I don't want to read the news. My heart's already black and blue. I'm putting on my combat boots, 'cause I got an attitude. We're like soldiers forced to fight a war. What the hell? I can't take it anymore. 'Cause for so long we've been patient, now we're done. And don't you even ask me, when did I become such an angry black woman?
It's a whole full-blown combination that distorts any true ideal of familyhood among us as a group in this country. And yes, I know there are some who's going to say, well, all families ain't like they. Listen, okay, to a certain point, I could concur with that. But then again, that's just to a certain point. Because even families, or those that appear to be like families, I would say, you know, sometimes you got to understand at the right time, place of circumstances, that or who you thought was a family member, or those who you thought were family members, would turn on you quicker than somebody on the street would. And as someone say, that's a fact. So you got to remember, because I've known certain relatives for years that I thought I was actually close with. And came to find out I got a big, hard hit surprise that still kind of even hurt me today. But I got a very, very hard, big learning surprise from that, to realize that in actuality, they wasn't ever really family. Especially when it came down to agendas and all this other crazy stuff. You see what I'm saying? So, and that has happened not only just with those amongst my relative bloodline, but that has happened with other relative bloodlines ever since mankind stepped foot on this earth. You see what I'm saying? And I'm not the only one who's been in that situation, and the first nor the last one who will be in that situation. You see what I'm saying? So, you know, like I said, and see, this is another thing. Not only with soul people, but with other groups of people as well, that they don't understand the truth about the difference of what family is and what a relative is. But especially in the case, since I'm speaking on our people, soul people, you see what I'm saying? Because we've let that go on to our head so far that we would even tell each other, no matter what goes on with us, amongst relatives, family is still family. No, that's not true at all. But I know there are those of you, some of those of you who may even be watching this live stream might be saying, you don't agree with that. Okay, that's fine. I'm not here, like I said, we're not here to try to save nobody. We just here to give advice. no more or less. You see what I'm saying? That's your choice if you don't want to accept that as the truth. But just know, one day, even if you thought you never had no issues with those that you are related to, that you look at as family, just know one day there is a strong possibility that you might just find out the truth, that after all, a lot of them people wasn't really your family. Like I said, let a right time, a situation, or circumstances pop up, and you'll find out for yourself the hard way, like I even had to. You see what I'm saying? So, you know, it is what it is. And I remember, like this brother who I watch sometimes called Phil the Advisor, you know, or Philip Scott, as he called himself on the African Diaspora channel on YouTube. I just seen a recent video by him, and he said, he made a statement that I do, even though I don't agree with him on a whole lot of stuff, but he made a statement that was so true that you couldn't even take a thick knife and cut through it. You see what I'm saying? Because the truth was just that solid that he pointed out when he said that what he's doing on his platform, if he was to train a white woman to actually do the same thing while saying the same things on the platform that he speaks from, that more soul people, a dark-skinned people, would agree with that Caucasian woman than they would agree with him. By that Caucasian woman getting higher thumbs up, you know what I'm saying? Than he would. Or more subscribers than he would. You see what I'm saying? And to a certain point, I had to concur with what he said. Because he spoke on Willie Lynchism in that topic, as a matter of fact. And because Willie Lynchism is true, as we see the effects of how it's affected us for centuries in this country as a group, you know, it's definitely clearly evident that we will believe anything that the Caucasians say, even if they saying the same thing that some of us wouldn't agree with each other on, whether it be a lie or truth. By the way, it ain't necessarily got to be a lie. It could be the truth we could be telling, like he was saying. And they will believe that Caucasian woman more than they will believe him. And that's because of that Willie Lynch mentality, which some say, I used to hear people in the conscious community call a farce, and that it's no such thing as Willie Lynch. But that's a whole nother thing in itself that I'm not going to go into right at this time. But it was a true story about a British Caucasian called Willie Lynch, who was a slave owner in the British West Indies, who came over here to America and gave the American white slave masters the game on how to keep their slaves under control. You see what I'm saying? And obviously, ever since then, it has worked, because we could see as of that result of what position that we're in now as a group. You see what I'm saying? So here's the thing. you know, we have to wake up and realize and understand one thing, that we're so backwards. And I want to point out something too, because I understand that there are some of those of us for some reason, who don't want to focus on the buffoonery when it comes to soul people selling each other out or doing the bidding of the Caucasian races in this country to help keep their own people oppressed. You see what I'm saying? Whether it be on the level of law enforcement, the so-called court criminal justice system, you know, and in other ways that we help, you know what I'm saying, to keep our own people oppressed under the iron fist of the Caucasian races in this country. You see what I'm saying? And I know even those in the pro-black conscious community are not as well as outspoken about that as you would expect them to be for some reason. But I'm going to say this here. Because we as a whole, far as a group being concerned, haven't addressed the internal enemy within our ranks is why we also continue to be held back as a group in this country from further progressing, especially to become a true free people. We haven't addressed that. We was very ineffective during the civil rights movement in addressing that. Because we used to just let anybody join our organizations. I know the organization I was a part of, and the leader of that organization was definitely a criminal himself in a wacko case, okay? But that don't justify the fact or the truth that you had undercover government agents in that organization, which is one way of how that organization was took down with that leader's own help, unfortunately. You see what I'm saying? You know, you had law enforcement officials in there, and I could personally speak on that because of the ways that I saw or experienced getting treated by other members of that organization, you see, or what I witnessed, what other members went through of being mistreated by those in that organization. Okay, so You know, I could speak on stuff like that. But I must say this. Even whether it's with the Nuwabians, the Nation of Islam, the Moore Science Temple, the UNIA that was up under Marcus Garvey, all that had government infiltration, a law enforcement infiltration involved. Even other so-called leaders of different persuasions helped brought down Marcus Garvey, like W.E.B. Du Bois, who eventually ended up becoming a Pan-African himself, who died over in Africa. You see what I'm saying? Yeah. So, I mean, it's like, you know, when you see this type of stuff going on, you know, and we don't address this, then, as a result, we see why organizations was destroyed the way they were, even during those periods of times, even up to more recently, because we did not address that. Hey, Brother Talik, could you hold on just for a second?
Yeah.
All right.
Thank you. commercial arsenic currently available.
So it was other two friends. And one of the aunts is 3 17-year-olds. Having the same sexually transmitted disease.
The government of all three boys in the same DNA. Could they have gotten it from each other?
Yeah, it's doubtful. Autopsy showed no regular oral infection.
Shout out to Angel Snuff Number 7. You can't fool Angel Snuff Number 7 with the religious bullshit. That man right there, let me give Angel Snuff Number 7 his props. That man is on a level. He
right. I'm back, brother.
Listen to Angel Snuff Number 7.
So, he's a real anyway,
he don't listen to no God and all lies.
Once again,
Mohammed and Buddha and all that.
I must
shit.
Say, he doesn't listen to further on that. On that note as well, is why we was not careful of what type of leaders we had, like we still aren't today, that we allow ourselves to be misguided by. And, you know, I have to say that law enforcement has played a heavy part in destroying us as a so-called once community. And we can see it every day throughout these United States. I want to share a story that I don't even think you ever heard me talk about publicly. Except on a one-on-one basis, Brother Talib. But I want to talk about this young man who was around the same age as me. And he was a brother. But first of all, because of respect for his anonymity, I won't mention his name or nothing like that. But he owned the business back home where I was from.
Mm-hmm.
And his business was the only black business in the area at the time. It was a clothing store business. And I remember when the police department in my hometown relocated this one precinct from another area of the city, right across the street from where the business stood at. They started coming over there, checking on different businesses, including that brother's business, by asking people, just introducing themselves because of the new precinct spot that they got across the street, right? Wanting to know how safe people felt in the community as far as running their businesses and all that, and if they needed whenever they needed their help or whatever, they could, you know, contact them or whatever the case was, right? So that's how that started off, with the police ending up constantly coming in and out of his business store just about every day. And it got to the point where his business was the only place the police frequented, even especially when they was on their lunch break or something. They would actually come in there, hang out, talk to the brothers that was working in there, yada yada and all that kind of stuff. And we talked to him or what, of course. And then it went from one point to where the police started giving him so-called advice on how he should run his business, which shouldn't be the police place to tell somebody else how to run their business. You see what I'm saying? So it went from that point on to, you know, that same police coming in there one day, and I wasn't even there. And he actually came behind the front counter of the business and started raiding that brother's business, going through all his important paperwork, throwing his paperwork around. You know how the police do when they call themselves on the raids, and he didn't even have no warrant officially to execute that raid. You see what I'm saying? So it got to the point where he even one day kind of physically assaulted me. I'm standing right by the front glass case where they got the glasses at. Because, you know, I'm doing security, right? And the police come brush me to the side. Let me get in here and see what I want. Didn't say excuse me enough. You see what I'm saying? And my first instance was to respond. Because I'm a man too, a human being. Just don't, you know, throw your weight on me or physically, you know, violate me like that without expecting some kind of response. You see what I'm saying? So my boss, who is that brother I'm talking about, that owned the business, looked straight at me and nodded his head, gave me the signal. Let it be. Okay. I respect for him. It was what it was. Because I would have said something to that police other than that. You see what I'm saying? And at the time, I was on the state paper. But I didn't give a damn. I would have said something to him. Point blank. Just don't disrespect me like that. I don't care if you a cop or not. You know? And whatever would have happened from there, hey, you know, it would have been whatever. Fortunately, it didn't get to that point, but hey, you know, he was out of line. So it got to that point where he could come in there and try to throw his weight around on people, just like in the case of scenario of example that I just explained. So then his partner, who played the good guy, you know, the bad guy, the good guy like Starsky and Hutch, you know, the good guy, which was his partner, came up, would come up in there that would always talk to people in a more, a more civil, tactical way. You see what I'm saying? Or rather, in a more diplomatic way, I put it that way. He will always be the one to be calling the brother to the way to the back of his business, to the back of the store where nobody could hear what was being said between them. Now, why every time, numerous times, which I saw with him coming in there and telling this brother to come to the back? What I'm saying, and I didn't think about it until I recently talked to somebody else about it, to say it could have been that they was trying to strong arm him, because some of them police who don't really make that much money on their job, that's what they do to earn an extra income, go around to these certain different businesses and just try to strong arm people, you know. So as time went on, this same guy that I just told you about that assaulted me, well, is illegally raided his place of business, right? End up having to turn his gun and badge in. I found out because he was acting crazy. And matter of fact, he wasn't even on duty from what I heard. He was acting crazy, doing some crazy, wretched stuff. And he actually had to turn his gun and badge in. Again, I eventually heard a while after that they had gave him back his gun and badge. Because most of the time, even when these police is outright wrong, they know it, but they still won't do nothing about it. You see what I'm saying? So he was back on the beat, carrying that gun and badge. You see what I'm saying? And then I heard he even said some negative stuff. Because the brother would tell me that he said some negative stuff to his partner about him. This after he stopped coming around I guess after he got his badge and gun took from him the first time. You see what I'm saying? No sooner later, after all this go down, a while later, I come to the store to help open it. And over to come to work that day, the store shut down. The Korean business right next door to it, which part was the Korean part of the Korean family that gave that business to the brother, by the way, because he worked with them for about 20 some years, very loyal to them, and so they decided to hand the business over to him. But anyway, this Korean woman was like, they killed him. And I was like, of course, broken to pieces, like, what? You know, this brother, he was just a businessman. Monday through Friday, Saturday, came, did his thing, you know? You know, he might have had people from a dark past that came through and frequented his business and this and that. But me personally, I don't know about him being involved in nothing illegal. You see what I'm saying? So what happened was, first thing come to my mind, of course, was, did they know anything about this? Or was they behind this? The police I'm talking about. And listen, I'm going to show you how dirty those amongst us are. To make the long story short, that police, the good one, the so-called good one, ended up going to the brother's funeral. After all said and done, talking about he was going to help find the people that killed him in a robbery that happened in a different precinct district. You see what I'm saying? Which they could have helped do something about, you know, because no matter what district it is, the police is going to work with the police whenever they decide. You see what I'm saying? But apparently in this case, wasn't nothing done. As far as I still know today, they never caught the killers. They killed this brother. So the next thing now is, did in fact these motherfuckers have, excuse my French, but did they have something to do with it? You see what I'm saying? And did they cover up their tracks? As well as letting the person that actually did the crime get away with it, you see what I'm saying? Or even pay them off. I guess since they couldn't find nothing criminal that they could use to prosecute this brother. And then, like I said, this is sole brother. He owned a business worth of $100,000+ worth of merchandise in there. Just trying to make a living like everybody else. You see what I'm saying? This is the type of envy and jealousy that goes on amongst us as well. On all levels in the so-called black community. You see? But when the law enforcement have their hand deeply in that, like I said before, we don't address that. Because we so quick to say, man, listen, I ain't thinking about no police or fuck the police. No, no, you just can't have that attitude. You got to look at it from all sides of the angle to be able to be able to address when the police abusing their power, especially toward us as a group in this country. This is why they could shoot us down, kill us all, like they did the Michael Browns, the George Floyds, the Ezell Fords, the Eric Gardners, the Sandra Blands, the Breonna Taylors, and the list go on. This is why they could just knock us off. Which some consider as a minor form of genocide, or a rather smaller form of genocide. But that's why they could do what they do. because we don't effectively address this type of stuff. And our people, as well as, of course, as our leadership go, because I even see, even in my area, whether they're current law enforcement people or retired law enforcement people, they still profile dark-skinned people. They sit back and watch Caucasians do whatever they profile in a black person for and let them just slide on and get away with it. You see what I'm saying? But the study would profile us. And I ain't just talking about, of course, the white cops, especially the black cops. It's who I'm talking about. You see? So it's no different. Plus, the police is the police when it come to all them wearing blue. You see what I'm saying? But here's the thing about it. The moral of that true story I just gave you is why we cannot get nowhere, because we don't address that type of stuff. We've just laid down and let people just do whatever they want to do to us. You know? I don't care where we at in the United States. We have laid down and just let people do whatever they want to do to us. Even after the George Floyd situation in 2020, you had people marching, rioting, tearing up cities around the country, all this stuff, just to get one peck of wood sent to prison. And he didn't even get the time he was really supposed to get. You see what I'm saying? But now, you still constantly got these police killing us. Even the black ones more have gotten to the point where they just outright killing us. Like them police did to that brother, Terry Nichols in Memphis, Tennessee. Or, you know, it's like getting point. Where now we don't have no, of course, like I always say, we had a control of a thing behind us, Mississippi, hotel and stuff, you know, like circumstance. Therefore, like I said earlier, even whatever that you believe exists, ain't Termination. People are for extermination. Folks, they Nazi Germany. They do have set up. Live concentration camps that are not occupied to put our ass in. All the folks have, just like I remember Brother Tony, he was talking about that situation in Alabama, right? And you said that so-called black, so black people really hate. Oh. No, us. Entry in there. You so we got all earning that title to even be considerably called by as a group. So, I mean, you know, we have a situation now to where they could come and do whatever they want to do to actually destroy us in this country. And then, listen, I hear, you know, it's another subject I really don't care to go in at this time. But I hear people talking about the depopulation of the Caucasian, the European throughout the earth, as well as in this country. Okay, let's say if these other groups did take control of the politics and the leadership in this country, right? What would it be for us? And soul people, because picking back off of something you said a while back, a year or two ago, was these people could look at you and say, well, you allowed the Caucasian to enslave you over 400 years, so why should we care about you?
Exactly.
You see what I'm saying? So see, that's what people is actually missing when they want to talk about this kumbaya, black and brown coming together type stuff. You see what I'm saying? First of all, look at the history. Hispanics never really had any interest in our plight.
Mm-hmm.
in this country. The Native American neither. If anything, some of them even had us in slavery in this country. We were actually on their plantations. And the only reason some of us get that money that them Indians get through the what they call the Indian Brewers affairs or whatever. The only reason some of us sold people who were enslaved by them, like in places like Oklahoma, get them government benefits because some of those people were up under their slavery. They was enslaved by them. So when they got them reparations, quite naturally, the black ones who call themselves black Cherokee Indians or whatever, got them reparations too. Uh-huh. You see what I'm saying? And to this day, they still trying to fight not to give them black so-called Cherokee Indians reparations, like in places like I mentioned, like Oklahoma. You see what I'm saying? So they really don't give a damn about us either. Matter of fact, they still got a gripe with us because we actually fought in the American Indian War, where we helped those when they called us the Buffalo Soldiers, I believe.
Right.
And we helped the United States government to wipe out more of their tribes. Okay. So they still got a gripe against us for that. Don't forget that, black man and woman in America, as Elijah Muhammad would say, you know. Don't forget that. We definitely, we played a part in their destruction as well. And they still feel a certain type of way about that.
Mm-hmm.
I even see a lot of Native Americans in this area where I'm at. That's very bold with their racism and prejudice toward soul black people. You see what I'm saying? We'll call you the nigger word faster than a white person will. Okay? So let's not get that twisted. We got to understand the history and aspect behind this whole thing that we as a group are up against. You know, like I've been hearing them Palestinians or so-called Israelis calling out Black Lives Matter or so black people for not, you know, speaking out on the atrocities that's going on with the Palestinians at the hands of the Israelis. But I say, you know, like they stay on cold when it comes to our oppression in America, we should return the same favor. And it's just that simple. You know what I'm saying? Because for too long, we've allowed ourselves to be involved in other people's struggles, other people's liberation, like we started with the so-called American Revolutionary War against the British. We've allowed ourselves to be so entrenched in helping other people to be free that we forgot about our own selves and our own freedom and liberation. You see what I'm saying? So, and when it comes to ours, our plight, just like with the recent Black Lives Matter movement, you didn't see all them people talking about we can't breathe. You see what I'm saying? When they was stomping out people like George Floyd, killing off people like Breonna Taylor. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
You didn't see them around like that, hand in hand, side by side, with soul brothers and sisters in the streets throughout America. You didn't see them going to jail or getting shot by the police like that, right? So why should we engage in their struggle and they don't give a damn about ours? It's just that simple. Look at how them Arabs, them same Palestinians you want to talk about, them and other Arabs, look at how they treat us in our neighborhoods when we allow them to come in there and occupy their businesses in our neighborhoods. They get rich off us in our neighborhoods. You see what I'm saying? So hell no. So black people should be on code when it comes to that. You know? I mean, it's that time. If we gonna stand up any kind of way and be counted for something, then whatever happens in that case is very necessary. Even if it have to start off with us being on silent code when it comes to somebody else's plight. It got to start from somewhere. And of course, like our platform agenda is taking control of a state. And we could definitely do better with that by taking control of a state that we could call a sanctuary for soul people in America. You know? So, it's like, you know, we have to understand these things for what it is, because tomorrow is not promised to none of us, you know, and we all got a date approaching us, and that's called death, you know, and it don't matter where we go from here once we transition, but one thing we need to do is concentrate on while we're amongst the living, doing something that we could at least, you know, die in dignity for, instead of just falling for anything and just dying out like flat out cowards, sissies, you know? And it's really at the point now that that's where we're going. And like I said, this thing, like me and the brother been talking about for years on this platform, they do got concentration camps set up for us. Go back and look at what Ronald Reagan did. It was called, I believe, Rex 1984, something like that, when they were actually developing the idea about putting black Americans in concentration camps. That started during the Reagan era. And it's been continuing like that since. They've been gearing up for us to be exterminated. But because we act just like the Jews of the Nazi Germany period, when we wasn't paying attention to certain things, and we see what happened to them as a result, the same thing could happen to us right here in America as a result. And America is a much greater superpower than Germany was under Adolf Hitler. Don't forget that. So they got the resources to do to us whatever they want to do, and ain't a damn thing we can do about it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so, it's like, we either sit on the pot or get off the damn pot and do something about our situation, or simply face extermination. That's just so simple as that. You know, because at the end of the day, brother, I am sick and tired of us out here crying, protesting, marching, which ain't working. We should have saw that when Martin Luther King woke up and said he was afraid that he guided his people into a burning house, or led his people into a burning house, rather than stay, you know? And today, we are still blind to that. when he actually woke up at the end of his life and saw the true light, when he made that statement before he died, you know? So my thing is that we all, 40 plus million of us in America, need to take that in consideration, that we are further entering more and more into the burning fire of a fallen house that's burning. As we can see what's going on around this nation. those of us who claim that we want to separate, I don't see what you're waiting for. Instead of getting behind the damn podium every Sunday like Eric Muhammad or some Louis Farrakhan night, you know, talking this crap and ain't really trying to separate from nothing, you know. but wanting to enjoy the fruits that come out of being in America, you see what I'm saying? That they benefit from, you know. But yet, you ain't really trying to make no move to separate, you know. And so, it's like what you're doing is you're just babbling off at the mouth, like somebody would say. You know, so I mean, I have to say that at this point in time, brothers and sisters, and those of you who may be listening to this live podcast, that we need to really wake up, and like somebody say, smell the coffee. Get off the piss pot, do something about our condition. At this point, it may be too late, like somebody would say. But we, as long as we still have the choice at the moment to make that decision by ourselves before somebody unfortunately makes it for us, you know, we need to make that decision to free ourselves, to liberate ourselves, because no one else is going to do it for us. And also, we must understand that we are in a time where, in fact, extermination may be at our very front doors. You know, because anything can happen. Look what happened while we was out and about doing whatever we was doing and wasn't paying attention to the signs. And here, bam, came COVID-19. You see what I'm saying? Anything can happen in the world at the right time of circumstances and situation. And much as they want us as soul people out the way, that may just be their very next moment of opportunity if another bigger situation arises, even similar to that. Because I must say, the races are tired of us. See, this is why they are allowing us, allowing these other different groups to come to this country, be it the Latin Americans, the African, the Asian, because they would rather replace us by allowing them to become their slaves, you see what I'm saying? Then to have to worry about dealing with us, because they know they got nearly 500 years of history to worry about when it comes to dealing with us. But they know they don't have that kind of history with them type of darker people. You see what I'm saying? They know they don't got that type of history with them other darker skinned people. So they'd rather let them flood this country like they letting the Mexicans and the Guatemalans and the Venezuelans come in here in droves like they are. You see what I'm saying? And you know, so they could push us out the way. See, we not reading like someone used to say we got to recognize the signs and symbols of the conscious mind. Since you say you're conscious, well, then you need to recognize the signs and symbols of the conscious mind. You see what I'm saying? To be able to recognize what's happening. For real. Because we are in a situation that we could be had just like that. We've had other people warn us for years on that note. And we still haven't grasped on to that warning sign. See what I'm saying? That's how we ended up getting in slavery in the first place. You know, and I must say this. You know, I'm not trying to sound like a Kanye West when I say this. I just want to make that perfectly clear. But we had choices to prevent slavery from happening. I'll put it that way. See, he said slavery was a choice. No, not slavery itself. Understand the context I'm putting it in. Preventing the probability of slavery was a choice for us. But we didn't take that sign initiative because we were so against each other. First of all, as tribes and all this other different stuff. So that's how they were able to do their thing. And from that point on, this is how we ended up in the situation that we still find ourselves in today as a group. Whether we came from Africa, whether we came from the Native American tribe, whether we came from the Caribbean or wherever we came from, we all eventually ended up here in this whole, you know, mess. Now we got to work together to get ourselves up out of this big mess. You see, by paying attention to the signs, as someone would say. So, you know, on that note, I will end, you know, with my presentation on this topic. And I would like to also say to those in the chat that were listening, I appreciate you for listening. And those of you throughout the rest of social media land, and those of you that are as far as away in Belgium and England that do listen to our platform, if you were listening tonight, I would want to send my shout outs as well to you. You know, and to anybody else who's listening. Because you never know who's listening to us. We can have some people in the entertainment sports world, like hip-hop or R&B, listening to us. You don't know who's listening to us. Even those in the conscious community in the nation, the Nubians, say, the Moors, Science Temple of America, mm-hmm. the Orthodox Sunni Muslims, the Christians, the Hebrew Israelites, you know, they, somebody from those schools of thought, as they call them, could be listening to us. You don't know who's listening to us. So we have to be very apparent in how we present this truth like it really is. And so once again, whoever was listening, I would like to send my shout outs to. And also, I would like to thank our number one soul brother, Charlie, for giving this opportunity to allow me on this platform to speak this truth tonight. And with that said, I will digress and yield the mic.